Good morning, students. Here we start with the greater sac horizontal disposition. Now, in the greater sac horizontal disposition of the peritoneum, we divide into two compartments. That will be one compartment above the level of transverse colon, another compartment below the level of transverse colon. So, today we are going to draw and discuss the horizontal disposition of greater sac below the level of transverse colon. So, it will be below the level of transverse colon. So we start with the horizontal disposition of the greater sac below the level of transverse colon, and we draw over here the posterior abdominal wall, then we draw the lateral abdominal wall, anterior abdominal wall, and once again the lateral abdominal wall. So I hope this is visible in this. Okay, now here this is the entire cross section, transverse section below the level of transverse colon. Very interesting. We start with anterior abdominal wall. So here, this is the anterior abdominal wall. Now, therefore, we start with our anterior abdominal wall. Inside, we are going to draw the peritoneum. And as already discussed in the last segment, the anterior abdominal wall will contain five major folds of peritoneum. And those folds we need to once again draw. And those folds, if supposing if we take this as midline, now here this is the midline, this is the first median umbilical fold. Similarly, over here there will be medial umbilical fold and then lateral umbilical fold, and then this will continue, the peritoneal lining will continue on the lateral abdominal wall. Similarly, on this side, since this is the median umbilical fold, here medial umbilical fold, on another side lateral umbilical fold, and then the peritoneal lining will continue on the lateral abdominal wall. So therefore, we are going to trace the entire peritoneum horizontal disposition from anterior abdominal wall, lateral abdominal wall, and we shall complete at the posterior abdominal wall. And this entire section will be below the level of transverse colon. So in the anterior abdominal wall, we start with the peritoneum disposition horizontally as well as vertically. It will be in such a way that here there will be the five major folds of peritoneum. The median umbilical fold, so therefore we have to keep on marking. So here we mark this as median umbilical fold of peritoneum. And this fold of peritoneum is because of the structure, that is median umbilical ligament. So therefore, we draw here the median umbilical ligament. This is the structure which we draw. And once again, we mark this as median umbilical ligament. Then there will be presence of medial umbilical fold. So therefore, here we mark this as medial umbilical fold. And this fold is because of the presence of obliterated umbilical artery. So here we draw this as obliterated umbilical artery. And therefore, we shall mark this as obliterated umbilical artery. And finally, the third fold will be known as the lateral umbilical fold. And this lateral umbilical fold, now this is the lateral umbilical fold. It will be produced because of the underlying structure, and that structure is known as inferior epigastric vessels. So here there will be presence of inferior epigastric vessels over here. So on one side we have drawn. Similarly, it will be on the other side also. This is the medial umbilical fold, lateral umbilical fold. This medial umbilical fold will be produced because of the underlying structure. That will be the obliterated umbilical artery, and the lateral umbilical fold, which will be produced because of the underlying structure, inferior epigastric vessels. Now, what is important is the presence of fossa. Now, as we can see very clearly in this diagram, these are the peritoneal folds. Medial umbilical fold, and lateral umbilical fold, total altogether five in the anterior abdominal wall, in the compartment below the transverse colon, below the level of transverse colon. The entire peritoneum of anterior abdominal wall will show these five folds. Now, in between these folds, we can see this fossa. So, special names have been given to this fossa. These fossa you have to remember. Just as peritoneal folds in the last segment, I had already discussed with you that these peritoneal folds in the vertical part, they are present in the anterior abdominal wall, infraumbilical part. They are present in the infraumbilical region, in the anterior abdominal wall, in the vertical portion, vertical tracing. Same these folds, we have to discuss in this horizontal disposition also. And this compartment will be below the transverse colon. So, such as these folds, in the last segment, as I already discussed, I had discussed with you that they are asked so many times in one mark question answer in MCQ. Similarly, fossa which are present in between these folds, where my fingers are there, they are also asked in MCQs or Viva or one mark question answer. These fossas, they are the basic concepts. Please understand this concept, the fundamentals. Now, we give the name. The fossa which is present between median umbilical fold and medial umbilical fold, this fossa is called supravesical fossa. Similarly, the fossa which is present between median umbilical fold and medial umbilical fold on the other side, it is also called supravesical fossa. So, supravesical fossa are depressions, peritoneal depressions present between median umbilical fold and on either side, medial umbilical fold. So, there are two supravesical fossae. So, here I will mark this as supravesical fossae. This is supravesical fossae. Even this is supravesical fossae. So, what are fossae? Peritoneal depressions. Where are they present? In anterior abdominal wall. In between what structures? In between the peritoneal folds. Where is the location of supravesical fossae? Between the median umbilical fold and medial umbilical fold, right and left. Then, between the medial umbilical fold, where my finger is there, and between lateral umbilical fold, where my finger is there, another fossa over here, and this fossa will be known as the medial inguinal fossa. So, here we give the name medial inguinal fossa. This is medial inguinal fossa. Once again, on this side, in between the medial umbilical fold and lateral umbilical fold, in between medial and lateral umbilical fold, this fossa over here, we mention it as medial inguinal fossa. Medial inguinal fossa. And then the last fossae, these right and left, both the side fossae, they are present lateral to the lateral umbilical fold. So, over here where my finger is there, this fossa will be known as lateral inguinal fossa. So, the fossa which is present lateral to lateral umbilical fold, this is the lateral umbilical fold, and lateral to lateral umbilical fold, the fossa which is present here, this fossa will be known as lateral inguinal fossa. Once again over here, this fossa will be known as lateral inguinal fossa. So, in this way, the fossa have been discussed. These are the lateral inguinal fossa, lateral to the lateral umbilical fold, and this lateral inguinal fossa are present opposite. Now, remember this point is very important. They are present just opposite the deep inguinal ring. So, here there will be presence of deep inguinal ring. Over here also there will be presence of the deep inguinal ring. And therefore, now we mark this structure as the deep inguinal ring. So, therefore, the lateral inguinal fossa is present in front of the deep inguinal ring. Now, simply we have to remember in such a way that since this fossa and the folds are present in the anterior abdominal wall, and therefore, now it is very important, we have to correlate this fossa, all the three fossa, that is the supravesical fossa, medial inguinal fossa and lateral inguinal fossa, with that of the inguinal hernia. So, it is basically very simple. We need to remember two major points. But before we remember these two major points, once again, there will be presence of deep inguinal ring in front of the lateral inguinal fossa. And what is deep inguinal ring? Where is the presence of deep inguinal ring? Deep inguinal ring is an oval opening. It is an oval shaped opening in fascia transversalis. Remember, deep inguinal ring is an oval shaped opening in fascia transversalis, 1.25 cm above the mid inguinal point. This is the proper location, this is the proper definition of deep inguinal ring. Oval shaped opening in fascia transversalis, 1.25 cm above the mid inguinal point. What is medioinguinal point? Midpoint between anterior superior iliac spine and pubic symphysis. Therefore, now comes the two important points. The first point, correlate, this is the correlation with applied anatomy, clinical anatomy. Any inguinal hernia, if it passes through, if the inguinal hernia will pass through lateral inguinal fossa, then that hernia is called oblique hernia. This is the definition. So, oblique hernia is the inguinal type of inguinal hernia in which it will pass through the lateral inguinal fossa. So, the inguinal hernia passing through lateral inguinal fossa will be known as oblique hernia. And the inguinal hernia which will pass through supravesical and medial inguinal fossa, if it passes through supravesical and medial inguinal fossa, then that inguinal hernia is called direct hernia. So, these two will be known as the direct hernia. These are the two points of applied anatomy here. Maybe asked in MCQ or one more question answer or viva. Any inguinal hernia passing through lateral inguinal fossa, it is known as the oblique hernia. And any hernia passing, any type of inguinal hernia passing through the supravesical fossa or medial inguinal fossa will be known as direct inguinal hernia. Now, after completing the anterior abdominal wall, the peritoneal lining in horizontal disposition below the level of transverse colon will then line on either side of the lateral abdominal wall. It will line the either side of lateral abdominal wall. And then it passes to the posterior lateral part of the abdominal wall. Then this peritoneal lining is passing to posterior lateral part of abdominal wall in such a way that here, this is what the lining will resemble. Here I am going to explain it to you. This will form the paracolic gutter and then the root of the mesentery. So, this is how the root of the mesentery will be formed and this is the mesentery. So, therefore, now over here, this structure will be known as the mesentery where it is covering, and here I will just make it thin over here and show the root of the mesentery in this way. And therefore, so here this will enclose the coils of small intestine, that is the jejunum and ileum, in this way. And therefore, we show inside, this is the cross section of the small intestine, the coils of jejunum and ileum. And now the explanation. Peritoneum lining the lateral abdominal wall and then it will pass posteriorly. Now as it passes posteriorly, it will cover two major structures. Now this is the one major structure and this major structure will be known as ascending colon. Now on the right side, it is ascending colon. Over here, this is another major structure where it is covering and this is known as on the left side descending colon. So therefore, the peritoneum which is lining the lateral abdominal wall will come posterior laterally and will cover the ascending colon and descending colon. But the way it covers, it will cover the ascending colon and descending colon on the right side, descending colon on the left side in such a way that on the sides of these two, they will form, where my fingers are there, they will form the paracolic gutters. This is very important. So therefore, over here where I put this arrow, this will be known as the right paracolic gutter. So this is how the right paracolic gutter is formed. The horizontal disposition, the horizontal tracing of the peritoneum covering the ascending colon on right side, descending colon on the left side, and it will cover from the front. Remember, it is covering from the front, but it will also cover the sides of the ascending colon and descending colon in such a way that it will produce the right and left paracolic gutter. So this is how the paracolic gutter is formed on either side. Now here you have to understand important relation where my hand is there. Just posterior to this, there will be presence of quadratus lumborum muscle. So the quadratus lumborum muscle will be present in this way. This will be the quadratus lumborum muscle on one side as well as the quadratus lumborum muscle here on the other side. So this is how quadratus lumborum muscle is present posterior lateral to the lining of the peritoneum. So therefore, over here, if we mark this as quadratus lumborum, and then it will cover psoas major muscle including the ureters. So psoas major and ureters also, they will be lined in this way. There will be psoas major muscle over here also. There will be presence of the psoas major muscle. So the peritoneum that is lining the posterior abdominal wall will be present anterior to the quadratus lumborum and psoas major muscle. This is the direction. So therefore, over here, we can mark this as psoas major muscle. And then after covering these two posterior abdominal muscles, as it covers the ascending colon and descending colon, both the sides of the peritoneal lining will pass towards the posterior abdominal wall in the median region. As it converges on the median region from the right side as well as left side, two important structures it will cover, inferior vena cava and abdominal aorta. So here there will be presence of, now here there will be presence of the inferior vena cava, and also there will be presence of, on the left side we draw the abdominal aorta. So therefore here we mark this as the aorta, and over here we shall mark this as inferior vena cava. So these are the two structures that the peritoneal lining, as it is coming on the posterior abdominal wall in the median region, it will cover. Now very interesting, on the right side, as we are tracing this peritoneal lining from lateral abdominal wall forming the right paracolic gutter on the side of ascending colon, covering the quadratus lumborum, then covering the ascending colon from the front, and then it will cover the psoas major muscle. And as it covers the inferior vena cava, the right side, when my finger is there, it will form the right layer or upper layer of the root of mesentery. So this will be known as the right layer. Now this will be known as the right layer or upper layer of the root of the mesentery. This is very important and interesting aspect. So on the right side, the peritoneum will then form the right layer of the root of mesentery. This is the right layer of root of mesentery or upper layer of root of mesentery, and then it will cover the all the coils of small intestine. Here this is a cross section, so we have drawn this small intestine in a cross section, otherwise it will cover all the coils of jejunum and ileum of small intestine. Then what happens? Then if we trace from the left side, on the left side the peritoneal lining, as it is covering the lateral abdominal wall, it will cover quadratus lumborum muscle, it will form the left paracolic gutter, it will cover the descending colon, then it will cover the psoas major muscle, and then it will pass in front of abdominal aorta, then it will form the left layer of the root of mesentery or lower layer of the root of mesentery, where my finger is there. So over here, this becomes the left layer of the root of mesentery, or this left layer will also be known as the lower layer of the root of mesentery, and then it will be continuous with the covering the coils of jejunum and ileum. So the right and the left layer, or upper layer and lower layer of root of mesentery, finally they merge by covering the coils of jejunum and ileum and form the mesentery. So this is how the root of mesentery, right that is upper layer, left that is lower layer, their continuation, and how they cover the entire coils of jejunum and ileum in the form of mesentery. So this is the point where the entire tracing of, horizontal tracing of the peritoneum in the compartment below the level of transverse colon is completed. Now the last point, this entire cavity, peritoneal cavity below the level of transverse colon, here we have to draw one important structure, and that important structure will be oblong shape. So therefore this is the lowermost portion of the apron like fold of greater omentum. So this present in the cavity of greater sac in the horizontal disposition below the level of transverse colon, we show that if we take that horizontal section below the level of transverse colon, we should know that the lowermost part of the apron-like fold of greater omentum is because of small intestine. So in front of this mesentery, the coils of jejunum and ileum, in front of them, there will be the four layers of greater omentum that already we have discussed in the previous segment. So the lowermost fold, this is the lowermost part of the greater omentum, apron-like fold of greater omentum, where we show the four peritoneal folds, the four peritoneal folds. And here, we draw the four peritoneal folds. I have used two colors to draw these four peritoneal folds. And remember, the first layer of greater omentum will be continuous with the fourth layer of greater omentum. And both these layers, they are derived from greater sac. So remember, the first layer where my finger is there and the fourth layer, both are derived from greater sac. The second layer will be continuous with the third layer of greater omentum. And both these layers, second and third layer, they are derived from the lesser sac. So remember, if I give the name 1, this is 4. First and fourth layer, this will be second, third layer. So the first and fourth layer of greater omentum, they are derived from greater sac. One mark question answer or MCQs. Second and third layer of greater omentum, they are derived from lesser sac. And the cavity here, which is present inside, we know that this cavity is the lowermost part of the cavity of omental bursa, or it is also known as the cavity of lesser sac. So here, this is the complete diagram of the horizontal disposition of the greater sac, the peritoneal lining of greater sac horizontally below the level of transverse colon. And do not forget to complete this structure in the last. This is the lowermost part of the lesser sac cavity, having all the four layers of peritoneum, which will form the apron-like fold of greater omentum. Lowermost part of the apron-like fold of greater omentum with all the four layers. And it is always present just in front of the coils of small intestine, in front of mesentery. So with this, we complete the horizontal disposition of the peritoneum in the greater sac, below the transverse colon. Thank you very much.